So how does this relate to the course content? So lecture 3 and most of lecture 5 will be actually spent in talking about how to make these microprocessor chips and what are the latest advancement in the technology, logic technology for making these microprocessor chips. Lecture 4 will be spent on talking about the cell which enables this flash memory and a lot of exciting developments that have been happening in that area. And so let's take a closer look at this flash memory chip. So if you open this die which has this flash memory cell. And shown here is this die which has 64 GB of flash memory storage. So what you see is, in fact, there are 16 of these chips which are wire bonded to each other. So they are connected to each other using these wire bonds. Each of them has 4 GB of capacity. So 16 into 4, that gives you overall capacity of 64, and they are connected together using these wire bonds. So lecture number 6, we will be actually talking about packaging and all the advances happening in that area. So looking back at this PCB, so there are so many chips here. There's this microprocessor chip, there's this flash memory chip, there's a DRAM chip. There's a separate chip for doing power management, right? There's a chip, there's an audio codecs chips over here. There are all these chips for enabling 3G and 4G functionality. So, if you imagine the next evolution of evolutionary thing in packaging, so wouldn't it be nice, if all these chips were on one single. If all these different chips were on, all these different functionality were on one single chip, and all these dies were placed together into one simple package, enabled, by maybe by flip chip bonding them into to a single package using micro bumps or something like that. So we will be talking about, this technology to enable this advanced packaging. So this in particular, this thing is called the 2.5D or the interposer technology, which would again we'll spend lecture 6 talking about that. And the next further evolution of the packaging, if you would imagine, would be to place all these chips on top of each other. So place all these dies on top of each other, maybe one for say microprocessor, the other one for DRAM, the other one for flash, place them all on top of each other and then connect them using these through silicon vias or these TSV technology. So we'll be covering that in this lecture 6 as well. So in the latter part of the course, we will be switching gears and looking into applications of nanomanufacturing into newer areas such as LED and solar. So we'll be spending one entire lecture, that would be lecture number 8, talking about LED technology. The focus there would be on especially on green LED technology and how which is enabled by this material called gallium nitride. So we'll be focusing on how to make high quality of gallium nitride and integrating into low cost substrates such as silicon and so on. So lecture 8 would be spent talking about that. And then we'll be spending a couple of lectures talking about application of nanomanufacturing into solar technology. So lecture number 9 and lecture number 10 would be based on application into the solar space. And what I'm showing here is essentially three different kind of solar panels, and they are made by very different technology, and you can pretty much tell what technology has been used to make these cells. And in most of the cases, you can actually pinpoint, one or two companies which might have made that cells just by looking at them. So, looking at this, and it's nothing, it's because they look so different. So this particular cell, by looking at it, I can tell that it's a crystalline silicon cell. This one is also a crystalline silicon cell, but it's a backside emitter and backside collector, probably made by sun power. And by looking at this particular panel, I can tell that it's a CadTel-based technology, thin film technology, probably made by a company called First Solar. So, you can tell a lot just by looking at how these cells look. So we'll be spending one lecture talking about crystalline silicon technology. So lecture 9 would be nanomanufacturing of these crystalline silica solar cells. And then lecture 10, which would be our final topic, would be on thin film solar technologies. So that's how we'll be, spreading. We'll be covering a lot of ground in this course, and we'll be using these short videos to supplement the classroom content. So I want to end this introduction by, coming back to this A5X chips, because I'm in awe of, how these mobile devices and the underlying chips, how they have, changed the entire semiconductor industry ecosystem. So let's take a closer look at this chip. So, the first thing you notice if you open up your iPad PCB is this heat sink, which is essentially used to spread the heat around coming from the chip uniformly throughout and spread it outside. And it also has this, nice logo of the chip. So if you remove it, what you see then is this thermal paste, which assists. So this is all part of the packaging, so this thermal paste assists in spreading this heat to this heat sinks. And then underneath, below, is this A5X chip, which is, flip chip bonded to this package. And so if you take that apart and you reverse, you flip the chip again, you see so shown here is essentially the chip as it looks. So this is the A5X chip, which was launched in March 2012, along with the product, the iPad 3. This is the A5 chip, which was launched in October of 2011. So this powers the iPhone 4S. And this is the A4 chip, which was, previous to that. So this powers the iPad 2, or the iPhone 4. So these chips defy everything we know about conventional Moore's law. So all three chips, they operate at a frequency of 1 GHz. Conventional Moore's law tells us that, the transistor speed goes up with every technology node, and the clock frequency accordingly should also go up with every technology node. That's clearly, not the case. All of these chips operate at operating at a VDD of 1 volt. So the operating voltage for all these chips is 1 volt. Again, this is, at odds with what you would expect with conventional Moore's law, which tells, every next generation of chips should operate at, 0.7x of the voltage of the previous generation. Also, if you measure the area of these chips, so on this chart, essentially I've drawn them, no, I've, pasted them in proportional to their area. So A4 chip has a area a die size of 53 mm square. A5 chip has a die size of 120 mm square. A5X chip has a die size of 162 mm square. So this is again, at odds with Moore's Law. So Moore's Law tells us that, going from one generation to other, the transistor size shrinks in half. So even if you put twice the number of transistors, your die size should remain the same. Again, clearly that is not happening. So a major reason for that is, a lot more functionality is now moved, from other chips to this processor system on chip. And so the thing to note here is, going from A4 to A5, your die size essentially, it increased more than 2 times. So your die size actually increased from, it increased 2.3x. And as you can expect, making a larger die would actually, reduce your yield further. So if you had to, make 100 million of these A4 chip, and as compared to, if you had to make 100 million of these A5 chips, you would need approximately 3 times the number of wafers to make these chips, because the die size itself is more than 2 times more, and then you expect, a drop in the yields as well if you increase your die size. So you would need, 3 times more the number of chips if you had to make 100 million I4S versus if you had to make, 100 million I4. And so, look at the timings of these chips, So this one was launched at in October of 2011, and this was launched early in 2012. So, since making these dies requires, more and more number of wafers, so companies which make, tools, which are semiconductor equipment manufacturer, their business was through the roof in 2011, because all of these chip manufacturers were adding capacity to, support these larger and larger die sizes for their iOS devices. And so, I mentioned a little bit about, cost earlier. So, say, let's say, Apple ships 100 million of, iPhones in 2012, and it ships 100 million of iPads in 2012 as well. So, it's 200 million devices. And as I mentioned earlier, each of them, cost, each of the microprocessor for each of those costs $26. So it's a $7.8 billion for making microprocessors for these iOS devices. And that's enough capacity to, justify the output of 2 to 3 wafer fabs completely, throughout the year. Their output would be consumed in making these iOS device, making the microprocessor for these iOS devices. Similarly, we talked about, flash memory. So, the flash memory required for these iOS devices, is enough to support the total capacity of 4 to 5 NAND flash fabs. So, as you can see here, what I want to make a case for is, these mobile devices and the underlying chips have completely changed the semiconductor industry landscape, and we'll be having, a lot of fun talking about these in future lectures. And I'll try to, relate back to this big picture whenever we are talking about, logic technology and so on, how it relates to this big picture. Okay.